Hi everybody. Today I'll talk to you about a novel solar cell based on a multi-terminal heterojunction bipolar transistor structure. First of all, a brief introduction about a different kind of energy source. In fact, they can be divided into non-renewable and renewable source. The non-renewable source are the most exploited one, and they are responsible of global warming and atmospheric pollution since they are based on fossil fuel system. Available alternative to non-renewable energy source is the renewable one, such as geothermal energy source or hydropower or biofuel or wind energy. They are ecologically friendly since they are natural source. Among them, we focus on the solar power that can be converted into electrical energy thanks to a device called the solar cell. The first solar cell based on silicon material was invented in 1954 with an efficiency of 6%. Just 30 years later, it showed an efficiency of 20% in 1985. Today, the highest efficiency of 47.1% is achieved by multi-junction solar cell based on 3-5 semiconductor materials. However, multi-junction solar cell cannot be exploited for terrestrial market since it has high manufacturing costs. In fact, the terrestrial PV market is dominated by silicon single junction solar cell with a demonstrated efficiency of 27.6%. This efficiency is close to the theoretical limit of 29% of the silicon single junction solar cell. So, in order to overcome this limit, a possible efficiency improvement is found in a perovskite silicon tandem solar cell, where the perovskite material that has an energy gap greater than the silicon one is placed on the top of a silicon bottom cell. The perovskite material is recently used for solar cell, and it can be considered as a hybrid material, an organic and inorganic material. So we can so it is an intrinsic material where the electron and the whole transport is allowed by an electron transport layer and an hole transport layer respectively for the electron and hole. The main features of the perovskite material is the low manufacturing costs, the high carrier lifetime, the tunable band gap depending on the halide used, and the high absorption coefficient. These features make the perovskite material, the perovskite solar cell, as an ideal top subcell of the silicon-based tandem solar cell. Actually, the perovskite silicon world efficiency record is around 29.52% achieved by the Oxford photovoltaic. It has a simple interconnection at module level. However, it has several constraints about current matching and tunnel junction. The current matching is linked to the fact that the perovskite and silicon subcells are interconnected in series in order to maximize the output power. So the two subcells should generate the same photocurrent. If the if the photocurrents generated by the two subcells are unbalanced, the total efficiency decreases. due to the current matching also, this kind of solar cell is sensitive to spectral variations in outdoor operation. The other constraints is linked to the fact that this kind of solar cell need a tunnel junction in order to generate the current flow between the two subcells. In order to overcome this limitation, we can exploit the multi-terminal approach. Among the multi-terminal approaches, a novel one is proposed by Marti, based on a three-terminal heterojunction bipolar transistor. So the new solar cell, the three-terminal heterojunction bipolar transistor solar cells, is able to achieve an high efficiency, avoiding the current matching and the tunnel junctions. Since it is based on a bipolar transistor, we can detect the two subcells, the emitter base subcells and the base collector subcell. These two subcells are electrically connected to a common base layer. Also, the generated electrical power is extracted through two independent loads. However, it is necessary to develop a model in order to assess the interplay role of the base and in order to develop design guidelines for this kind of solar cell. In order to do that, we have extended the classical Lovell model to the bipolar transistor under illumination, assuming that in the quasi-neutral region there is only the diffusion mechanism transport, and in the depleted region only unitary collection efficiency, meaning that for each photon absorbed there is one electron hole couple photogenerated. Then we have assumed an ideal transport at the hetero interfaces, neglecting the photorecycling. Once solved the model, we have arrived to a circuital description of this solar cell that can be thought as two back-to-back solar cells independently connected, adding the transistor effect. The photogenerated the generated current due to the transistor effect adds up to the photocurrents, but in parallel the dark current are enhanced too when the coefficient alpha, that is the common base current gain, is close to one. Meaning that the transistor effect provides a power loss, and so we must suppress this effect. In order to suppress this effect, it is necessary to minimize the electron injection in the base, making the coefficient alpha close to zero. In order to do that, it is necessary to design the base with a doping greater than the emitter one, and choosing a material for the base if needed with an energy gap greater than the emitter one. Let's underline that these are bad design rules for the traditional bipolar transistor. Once solved the model, we have studied the perovskite silicon solar cell heterojunction bipolar transistor solar cell using as an all transport layer the spirometad material. Then we have the perovskite p-doped emitter. For the base, we have used an hydrogenated amorphous silicon. And for the peak doped collector, the crystalline silicon material. By the table, we can observe that we have designed the base with an energy gap greater than the emitter one, and a base doped with a doping greater than the emitter one. So in the slide, we can observe the external quantum efficiency. That is decreased due to the fact that we have not used the anti-reflection layer. Also, since the emitter is thin, a certain fraction of photons at long wavelength are not absorbed and escaped towards the base and the collector layers. Now, let's observe the JV curve subcell, first subcell that are obtained keeping constant the other subcell voltage. First of all, in the plot, we can observe the emitter base voltage that is the same for any value of base collector voltage. Then this is the bottom JV curve, so the base collector JV curve for an emitter base voltage equal zero. Then when the emitter base voltage approach its maximum power point, we can observe that the new JV curve is overlapped to the previous one, meaning that there is no interplay between the junctions biased up to its maximum power point. Finally, when the emitter base leads to its open circuit voltage, the base collector JV curve is shifted up respect to the previous previous one, meaning due to the fact that is a negligible transistor effect at the base collector junction. However, in practical case, it is not a problem since the solar cell works at its maximum power point. Since at the maximum power point, the transistor effect is absolutely negligible, the transistor effect is suppressed, and this kind of solar cell achieves an high efficiency ranging between 27.1% to 28.6%, depending on the radiative coefficient and the energy gap of the perovskite layer. So, in conclusion, we have developed an optoelectronic model based on the Hovell model for these three-terminal heterojunction bipolar transistor solar cell. And we have observed that the transistor effect can cause a power conversion loss, but it can be suppressed with a proper design. Finally, the three-terminal heterojunction bipolar transistor solar cell has potential for high efficiency equivalent to a double junction solar cell with independently connected terminals. That's it, and thanks for listening.
Thank you, Gemma, for your talk. Now, I will read some questions that we received during your talk. The first one is this one. In your opinion, will cheap alternatives ever be able to reach the 40% efficiency of the multi-junction solar cell, the one not employed for terrestrial use?
Today is very difficult to reach 47.1% for terrestrial solar cell because the manufacturing costs for this kind of solar cell are very high. In the future, if the manufacturing cost will be lower, and if we will able to use, for example, the perovskite material in a multi-junction solar cell, maybe we can arrive to this efficiency.
Okay, thank you. Now we have another question. Which parameters still have to be accounted for in the solar cell model? For example, there is another question that is related probably to this one. For example, do you keep into account temperature in your model? For example.
Okay. In this case, I didn't take into account the temperature. It is fixed to the traditional temperature because it is for terrestrial use. However, for terrestrial solar cell in general, the humidity it is an important factor in order to evaluate the performance of a solar cell. However, it is a first step of my study about this kind of solar cell.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. Well, there is a final question. Which tools do you employ for developing your models? For solving, for example, the problem of finding the small model?
Can you repeat?
Which software tools do you employ for...
MATLAB tools.
Okay, perfect. That's all. I see, yeah, that's all. So, thank you, Gemma, for your talk.
Thank you.